Good morning and welcome to the service at Rosedale Presbyterian Church. This has been a busy season for us. This is a moment of transition for those of us that are in the choir. We did actually get farewell to one of our beloved choristers a little while ago, but this is the final time the choir will sing together prior to reforming after Labor Day. So I want to take just a quick moment to thank them for their dedication, their many hours and work both together as an ensemble and individually as choristers for singing for our services all year and various other commitments. Both funerals were blessed as well. My Monday opened and blessed by the contributions of the choir. And as a little, another special event I'm going to mention in a moment. But on your behalf and on personal behalf, thank you very much to the choir for your contributions this season. There are two musicians that, within my personal memory as a member of the Toronto music scene, that have been formidable and strongly identified with the Rosedale Presbyterian Church. One was Dr. John Larson, who is still very much around in the next 5 years here in Toronto. But the other is Mary Lay. Mary is a distinguished predecessor of mine, and we share with a beautiful ensemble of female voices that lives here, rehearses here every Wednesday at Rosedale, and also gives its performances here. We share nearly as an important part of our history. This afternoon at 2:30, the Pentecostal singers which Mary founded in 1997 and which continue under the direction of Allison Allen will be giving a special concert in Mary's memory. Mary passed away during the pandemic, and so there was no real opportunity for public observance of for wonderful presence here. So I hope you will have an opportunity to join us this afternoon. The concert begins at 2:30. It will last about an hour in length. The Rosedale Choir will, in fact, have the honor of contributing some music of its own to this performance this afternoon. And so I do hope some of you will be able to avail yourselves of that opportunity. It will be very beautiful and fun. And then we'll see if raising the curtain. No, the concert is at 2:30. That's every public announcement I've ever seen, but it's at 2:30. Thank you, Lindsay. Yeah, so if you come to 2 o'clock, that's fine. I'm sure there are other healthy people coming. So we'll hear music at that point, probably too. So thank you very much. And one final announcement. If you came in by the back door of the church, you may have noticed this little pile of calendars. I'm going to tell you very quickly of the Organ Historical Society of North America and the Royal Canadian College of Organists are holding a joint convention in Toronto at the beginning of July. Several events are going to be hosted here at Rosedale in honor of a very special organ that this congregation enjoys and installed in this church back in 1982. And little file calendars and some beautiful photographs of the principal organs in Toronto, including this one, are available just anyway in promotion of those events of this summer convention. There's a file in the back of the church for anyone who's interested. It's very much worth picking up and grabbing them. So, thank you very much.
Thank you, Chris. And I just want to add my gratitude to the choir as well. We are blessed to have such a wonderful group of voices that we have to worship every Sunday. So thank you very much. Our opening hymn is saying, "Your praise to God," Psalm 423.
Steadfast love. We come to worship with glad hearts to offer are the source of all good things. In you, all things work together for good. In this time of worship, we offer you thanks with our prayers, praise with our hearts, and honor with our lives, this day and every day, now and always. Amen.
Let us now with sincere hearts and a humble voice seek the forgiveness of God. We confess that we are quick to give up when things get difficult and quick to question your presence and your power. Forgive us. Grant us your patience and open our eyes to recognizing your leading in our lives, to listen for your gentle voice when we least expect it. And then give us courage to step out in faith and obedience, trusting in your leading, even when we can't yet see the outcome. Father God, help us to turn away from things that do not lead to life, from attitudes and actions that get in the way of our relationship with you, and distract us from hearing your voice and doing your will. Open our eyes and ears to your presence and call. Give us courage to take up our cross and follow where you lead, even if the path is uncertain or leads in unexpected directions. For you alone are God, and we are your people. Take our lives and use us for your glory. O God, hear our prayers in the silence of our hearts. God is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. Know that we are forgiven, and be at peace with God, with yourself, and with one another. In the name of Christ we pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our children's hymn is Know That God Is Good.
Thank you. God calls each of us to using the gifts given to us.
Some to be prophets, some to work miracles, some to encourage, and some to teach.
There are different kinds of gifts,
but the same Spirit.
There are different kinds of ways to serve God,
but one God to serve and worship.
Let us give thanks for the gift of serving.
Amen.
God, we celebrated Trinity Sunday, and we were reminded that God is the way that we create for God. God, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit. And this is a mystery and something we're all learning about. How can God be three things, but also a God? And there's no way to fully know everything we know about God. It's just not so. We're going to see more about the Trinity this week, so we're going to have a mystery. And we're really grateful that church here at Oakdale is a place we can come and we can ask questions about things we don't understand and learn a little bit more about God and truth. Whether it's 3 or 103, there's always something more to learn about God. And today we take a moment to celebrate and recognize all the places that we come together here at Oakdale to learn more about God. This Sunday is a good reminder of the promises of all of these people sitting out here in the Tuesday where we have a baptism. And they promise to help you learn about God and to grow in your faith. And they pray for you and they play with you and they learn from you too. And so we say thanks to them for their support and their prayers and their encouragement for us here. And we appreciate them for everything today. Today we also want to celebrate our Sunday teachers and our worship workers. You, sitting up here, are filled with lots of energy and lots of questions. So we thank our Sunday teachers for their patience and for their wisdom and love. And they prepare each week with grace, patience, and joy. So thank you, teachers and ministry. We're helping us to learn and grow this year, and we want to give you a whole sign of our thanks. I must admit, I didn't wear my glasses today. So, if you want to learn your Sunday school this year, can you give us a little wave? What is that for your Sunday school? Well, class is here, so we also have a class called the Kitchen, and the Kitchen is there faithfully. So, we will continue to come to those. It's important to also recognize and give thanks to our Mexican church friend, or you can get it for Jesus. It's the same problem. Our Mexican church friend, thank you for participating in coming out to each month. Our volunteers work hard to make sure that we're all safe, and each time we gather, and they help us with music, and they sit together with you, and they do activities, and they help set up and clean up, which is all over, and turn it all around the church. So, you can take a look at it if you want. Take a look at it. A little bit of a look at it. We're going to take one of those up to your arm. If it wasn't for your arm, our arm is going to be invisible. Your arm is a little bit of a music. So, you can follow this way to me. You can take a fire and click it. Thank you. Mark.
Thank you.
lesson of reading was taken from Isaiah, chapter 5, verses 15 to chapter 6, verse 6. I will return again to my face until we acknowledge their guilt and seek my face. In that respect, they will beg my favor. Come, let us return to the Lord. For it is He who has torn, and He will heal us. He has struck down, and He will bind us up. How for 2 days He will revive us. On the third day He will raise us up, that we may live before Him. Let us know, let us press on to know that the Lord is here and is secure at the door. He will come to us like a child, like a spring rain to the rock of the earth. What shall I do with you, Lord Abraham? What shall I do with you, Lord Judah? Your love is like the morning sun, like the dew that goes away early. Therefore, I feel men like prophets. I feel them by the words of my mouth, and my judgment goes forth into light. God is our steadfast God, and not sacrifice, but always a God, rather than very often. The word of the Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
The response of Psalms is number 33 and the time of your glory. For this reason, it depends on faith. in order that the Father to give us all grace, and began to be filled with descendants. Not only did he then hear from the Lord, but also to those who share the faith of David Abraham. For he is the Father of all of us, as it is written, I am made the Father of many nations, in the presence of God and whom he believed, who gives life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist. Opening the hands to him, he believed that he would be God the Father of many nations, according to what he said. So numerous shall the Lord descend into him. He did not weaken in the day that he considered his own body, which was already as good as dead, when he was about 100 years old. For when he considered the violence of Sarah's womb, notice God's made him greater concerning the promise of God. But he grew strong in his faith as he came glory to God, being fully convinced that God was able to do what he had promised. Therefore, his faith was reckoned to him as righteousness. By the words, it was reckoned to him, but written not for his sake in Rome, but for ours also. It will be reckoned to us, who believe in him who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead, who was handed over to death for our trespasses, and was raised for our justification. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
As many of you all know, we saw a man called Matthew sitting at the tax booth. And he said to him, "Follow me." And he got up and followed him. And as he sat with them in the house, many tax collectors and sinners came and were sitting with him and his disciples. And the Pharisees told him, he said to his disciples, "Why does your teacher treat your tax collectors and sinners?" But when he heard this, he said, "Those who are well have no need of physical teaching, but those who are sick. Come and learn what that means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice. For I come to call not the righteous, but sinners." While he was saying these things to them, suddenly a leader of the synagogue came in and knelt before him, saying, "My daughter has just died, but come and lay your hands on her, and she will live." And Jesus got up and followed him with his disciples. And suddenly a woman who had been suffering from hemorrhages for 12 years came up behind him and touched the fringe of his cloak. But she said to herself, "If only I touch his cloak, I will be made well." Jesus turned and seeing her, he said, "Take heart, daughter, your faith has made you well." And instantly the woman was made well. When Jesus came to the leader's house and saw the group of prayers and trials waiting in motion, he said, "Go away, for the daughter is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. But when the father had him was outside, he went in and took her by the hand and the girl of her cup. And he reported this prayer to our Christian Christians. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
In the end of the Lord, I think we have the same.
Thank you.
Young pastor was invited to become a new minister of a small country church. And on the first Sunday, an argument broke out concerning whether people should stand during the reading of the gospel or sit during the gospel reading. And this issue really bothered him. So the next day, the pastor visited one of the longest serving members who was in a nursing home. And he said to him, "In this respect, you are 100 years old. You are the oldest member of the church. So I come to you. I need to know, what is the church's custom during the reading of the Holy Gospel?" And the church said, "Well, why do you ask?" The pastor said, "Well, yesterday, during the reading of the Gospel, some people stood and some people sat. The ones standing were criticizing the ones sitting, telling them to stand up. The ones sitting started screaming at the ones standing, telling them to sit down." The old man said, "Well, that is our custom." In today's Bible reading, the disciples of John the Baptist wonder why Jesus doesn't follow tradition and custom regarding fasting. Earlier in chapter 9, Jesus gets criticized by the Pharisees for eating at the same table with the sinners. And in verse 14, he gets criticized for eating, period. And it seems to some that you can't do anything right. Verse 14, while Jesus and the disciples are having a meal, the disciples of John the Baptist come up to him and ask him, "How is it that we the Pharisees fast, but your disciples do not fast? You're just eating. Aren't you supposed to fast?" Now we see the practice of fasting throughout the Bible. Moses, Elijah, Ezra, Daniel, Jesus, they all went through a prolonged period of fasting as they sought God. In times of national calamity and personal mourning, sometimes called for fasting as a means of humbling oneself, mourning, and seeking God's mercy. At least once a year, on the Day of Holiness, Yom Kippur, the Jews would fast. They would also fast at the New Year, Rosh Hashanah. Some people would fast regularly, week by week. And regular fasting was the practice of John. And that's why the disciples followed that practice. And the Pharisees certainly practiced fasting, often proudly. They fasted twice a week. Many Pharisees were quite showy and ostentatious about it. But there were also many sincere Pharisees who fasted and obeyed the law, like Nicodemus. And that thing is familiar from John chapter 3. They were sincere. They were sincere in the practice of fasting, but still weighed down by the weight of legal and religious minutia. There were strict, detailed rules and regulations to follow in order to be totally religiously compliant. And so the Pharisees, they don't really expect it at all, people. Fast, twice a week. That's why they did. John's disciples were trying to abide by this practice, which is why they legitimately posed the question to Jesus. Why aren't your disciples fasting and mourning like the rest of us?
And in reply, Jesus gives an illustration explaining why His presence changes the way our lives are to worship and give honor to God. His very presence. He says in verse 15, "How can the guests of the bridegroom mourn while he is with them?" He turns it around on it. He changes the framing of it. Framing his arrival as a wedding celebration. And now is not the time for fasting. Now is the time to celebrate. There will be a time for fasting later when we have a reason to fast, but not just for the sake of fasting. In other words, this isn't a time for fasting. This is a time for feasting. The Savior of the world is here. Tax collectors and sinners are following Christ. It is time to celebrate, Jesus is saying. Don't you see the difference? People are responding to God's call. They're coming into the kingdom. And we need to acknowledge that, welcome that, and celebrate that. That's how Jesus responded. One scholar said, as a physician, as a great physician, Jesus came to bring spiritual health to sick sinners. As a bridegroom, Jesus came to give spiritual joy. The Christian life is a feast. Jesus then gives a second illustration explaining why his presence changes the way we should live. In verse 16, he says, "No one sews a patch of unshrunk cloth to an old garment, but a patch will pull away from the garment, making the tear worse. And no one puts new wine into old wineskins, for the old skins would burst from the pressure, spilling the wine and ruining the skins." Traditionally, wine skins were made of goat skin, and sometimes camel skin, depending on the area. And the legs and the tail were cut off and sealed. The wine is poured in, and it's tied off for the fermentation process. And this stage lasts about 2 to 4 months. And so the fermentation process slows down and stops. And by this time, the wineskin has evolved. It's been stretched to its absolute limit. The alcohol properties of the wine have destroyed the skin's natural resiliency. And so by now, the skin's ability to stretch is lost. It's at capacity. So the new skin is attached onto the old, and this skin is stretched, while the old skin does not naturally reveal tear. So Jesus is saying, you can't attach the joyful message of the gospel onto the old garment of static observance. Not involving the law, but the old practice of static observance. He's saying, I'm not here to catch up your old customs and understandings. I'm not here to do a patchwork job. Jesus makes it clear that he has come to do a brand new new wine is stored in new wine skins, so that both are preserved. Now, this doesn't mean you're not fasting on it. Again, Jesus never invalidated the practices of the law. He fasted himself. Jesus is emphasizing that this is a different approach, a different experience, a different lens through which we see and experience life in God. A brand new thing. So things like fasting are not invalidated, but it must be seen in a new way. In the light of the new Spirit of God's law written on our hearts. So the power is not in and of itself in the act of fasting, but rather it's centered on God. The heart of God, the vision of God, and where we're able to recognize reason to celebrate. Let all people come together into God's kingdom. When our minds and hearts are open, when we find our capacity for love has been expanded. This is the expression of love and faithfulness. Jesus has come with the radical gospel of good news, the good news of God for the poor, to disenfranchise the oppressed, the sick, the brokenhearted, the sinners and tax collectors, and to lift the poor. This good news aims to express the essence, the very heart of the ancient Judaic faith, which is a just love, a selfless love, compassion, acceptance, and mercy. And when we experience those and recognize them in the lives of others, we are drawn celebrate. Jesus is returning their attention. He's returning the people's attention to Micah's seminal call to a love for God and a love for one's neighbor, to do mercy, to love justice, and to walk humbly with their God. We are given the new wine of God's Spirit to be poured into the new wineskin of our faith, which has been refashioned by the call to forgiveness, redemption, and radical love. To God be all praise, honor, and glory. By the new covenant of God, our hearts are set anew, both in our praise offering to God and our service offering to the world. And so we humbly and graciously present our gifts in gratitude to God's faithfulness to us in every situation. Let us pray. as we sing in the scriptures, our hearts and prayer to God. Holy God, bless this gathering of your people, that we may grow and flourish in your love and grace for the purpose to which you have called us. Grant us such faith that we may place our whole trust in you. Feed our hearts and give us strength and courage to be active witnesses for you. May we also be open to the voice of your Spirit in our lives, that we may see with new eyes and hear with new ears the direction you would have us go. Father God, we come before you in prayer, listening to you with joys and concerns, the hopes and dreams of our lives. This day we lift up to you those dear to us. Hear our prayers for those in need of healing, of comfort, of solace. We offer special prayers for Robert's family as they grieve the loss of heaven. We are truly grateful for her service and ministry at Rosedale, and the way she has touched so many lives, young and old. Minister to families that continue to walk this road of mourning, and those that carry her spirit and memory in their lives. We also pray for the Millen family as they plan to celebrate Mary's life. Grant them your peace and comfort as they uphold her memory together. Gracious and compassionate God, you call us to love those whom you would love. You call us to bring wholeness to lives that are broken. You call us to bring comfort to those who are grieving. You call us to bring good news to those who are seeking. Guide us, bless us, uplift us, and hold us, for we are your children, all to your purpose in your world. Hear our prayers, those from our mouths and from our hearts. Heal and restore us, for we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's join our final and fourth and joyful, joyful, we adore you.
Oh,
send forth with your blessings to bless this world. In the name of Christ, God, and the Holy Spirit be upon you now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Yeah, we don't see it. Once the end of June comes, we won't see a number of people until after August.
Basically.
That's why no one's complaining about it.
It's safe.
They all like it.